and thank you for joining us on the Don Ha Business Connect show. We have a great lineup of guests. Philip McAllister from landlord.co.nz talking about property.
And you know, you've seen some really good yields and stuff in that apartment space as well. So I firmly believe that it's an area that property investors should be much more focused on.
From Fundmaster, we have Dev Dhingra.
So I always explain to my customers who are first-time buyers is that getting in is more important because equities can build over time, you can save over time.
We have an exciting portfolio of projects and properties offer, plus much more. And joining me now on the show is Philip McAllister from landlord.co.nz. Phil, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Don. It's great to be here.
Tell me, how long have you had the landlord.co.nz website and also the New Zealand Investors magazine?
So we started the New Zealand Property Investor magazine about 12 years ago now. The issue which we've just put out is issue number 163. So we've written a lot of words about property investment over the years. Landlords is a bit younger, but they both target the same audience, which is residential property investors. And they're an audience which are actually pretty active.
Yeah. And I recall, I think I did advertise in your magazine. So it's these magazines are available to be bought at the magazine stores?
Absolutely. So we a lot of the supermarkets, petrol stations like the BPs, the bookshops like Whitcourt and stuff, they all stock the magazine. It comes out on the first Monday of every month, so regular as clockwork. We come out every Monday, 12 times a year. And we also have a bunch of subscribers, so if you don't want to pay $9.95 every month for it in the shop, you're better to subscribe and you get a bit of a discount.
Okay, and what sort of content is in the magazine?
Yeah, we try to mix it up, so we have a lot of statistical stuff, so property investors love to learn about rents and yields and what's happening there. We run a lot of features, so like any of the big issues which are out there at the moment, and you know, one of the ones which we hear quite a lot about is, you know, meth, for instance. So we'll write a lot of stories about that. So it actually helps the property investors understand, you know, what they should be doing with their insurance policies and those sorts of things. We run a bit of technical content. So, you know, lawyers and accountants and those sorts of people who are giving some good advice to investors about, you know, what they should be doing. The key role of the magazine, and when we sit there and we put it together each issue, is to actually deliver content to people which will actually make them better property investors.
Do you report right around the country or just in the
absolutely.
Auckland
region? I always say that, you know, the centre of the property investment universe is Auckland,
right.
But there's also a hell of a lot of people outside of Auckland who invest as well. We there's certainly a bias to Auckland because it's just so big and there's more investors up here, but we live in Rotorua. We actually run the magazine out of Rotorua, and for instance, we have a lot of Aucklanders buy houses down there. They probably just like to come down for a holiday too.
Right. So, Phil, what's the difference between landlords.co.nz and New Zealand Property Investment Magazine? What's the difference between the two?
So, with the website, landlords.co.nz, that has a lot more of the newsy type information on it, but also has a lot of data. So you can go in there and you can look at house prices and you can do graphs of, so if you wanted to pick a suburb in Auckland and you wanted to see three bedroom houses, you could graph how the rentals have gone over the last 10 or 20 years. So you've got a lot more interactive tools you can play with. The magazine is what we call where we go behind the headlines and we dig into the news stories in more detail.
If you want more nitty gritty, you've got to buy the magazine.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't give it all away for free, can you?
No, well, you get the website for free, so you're getting a pretty good deal.
Yeah. See the investor behaviour, if they live in Rotorua, they buy in Rotorua, or they could buy in Wellington, Christchurch, or Christchurch, people buy in Christchurch, or they invest outside town.
A really good question, Don. A lot of people only buy in the areas they live in, but then you do have Aucklanders will actually buy outside of Auckland, partly because, you know, I guess the market here in Auckland is quite difficult at the moment for investors. You won't find an Aucklander, for instance, buying properties in Invercargill. That doesn't really happen, but you might get people in Dunedin will buy in Invercargill, and they're also quite similar markets because they have big student populations, which is a good example there. But people tend to buy in the areas they know.
How do you see the investor behaviour now on apartments? Because what's to say, like in 1994, there's only sort of like 400 apartments. In Auckland now, there's like 35,000 people living in Auckland and even more to come. How's that investors' behaviour towards a market of apartments?
Oh, we ask them that question quite regularly, and a lot of them are actually investing in apartments. And, you know, you've been through, you know what it's like with the property cycle. You go through different times, and you know, you've had some great opportunities to buy apartments in Auckland. You're getting more and more people living in apartments, so that makes them, you know, more attractive to investors. And, you know, you've seen some really good yields and stuff in that apartment space as well. So I firmly believe that it's an area that property investors should be much more focused on. Some people, you know, they like their, you know, their old wooden houses, but, you know, buying an apartment's, you know, got some really good merits, I believe.
Well, 7 years ago, look, I refuse to sell apartments.
Really?
I refuse to believe in apartments. 7 years later today, I sold the most apartments. And I see the capital gain. You know, 7 years ago, an apartment in Auckland City was averaging 200,000. Now it's going to 550 to 600.
But, you know, 7 years ago, apartments were still quite new and people didn't quite understand them and where they fitted in. I think apartments now are becoming much more mainstream. And we've actually done a couple of magazines just about apartments, just standalone magazines about apartments.
Okay.
And they've been actually really popular. And the other thing which is really interesting there is, you know, 7 years ago, Auckland was probably the only place you had apartments. I mean, now, you know, you've got quite a lot in Wellington, you've got places happening in Tauranga, we've even got some in Rotorua going on at the moment.
So I think it's all about education, the investor or the consumer to say, you invest in an apartment, they try it, they see the capital gain, but now the population increase, they see the demand, they understand it better.
Yes, yeah. And, you know, an apartment is actually quite a good stepping stone to get onto the ladder as well with some of the apartments which are available.
Yeah.
One of the things that we've found with the magazine is it's been a really important tool for people to actually get involved in property. And I've got lots of stories of people who basically knew nothing about it, but once they started to read the magazine and understand what was going on, they end up becoming investors themselves.
Where do you see the investors on 10 or 20 houses or even 30 houses, which is quite an achievement? What are they doing right now? Are they sitting on a fence, are they selling, getting rid of the old stock, replaced with new one, or are they quite happy where they are?
Oh, a lot of the guys with the big portfolios are tending to be just sitting there at the moment. You know, it's they're not necessarily as active in the market in terms of buying. Those people will always be looking at their portfolios because they're essentially professional property investors. You know, the market breaks into sort of three segments. You have a group who have, you know, one or two properties. Then there's another sort of big group who have around five or six properties. And then way down the end, there's this group of people who have 10 plus. And that's actually a growing part of the property investment picture at the moment.
Right. And where do you see the interest rate right now? Where is it heading? Upwards?
Oh, absolutely. You know, we've been through the bottom of the cycle. We've had probably the cheapest money that you and I will ever see in our lives.
Yep.
I don't think we'll see those sorts of interest rates again. They're still really low historically, but they're creeping up. And the banks are playing an interesting game at the moment. They're just doing little rises every couple of weeks now rather than, you know, the big 25.
What would the majority of the investor with the big portfolio, would they fix for 2 years? Would they fix portion of it?
They tend to fix, and all the research shows that you're actually better to fix 1 and 2 years and just keep rolling over your 1 and 2 year fixes. And a lot of property investors use interest-only loans.
Right.
Yeah.
As Kiwis, mate, we must be mad in properties because, I mean, we've got 4 million or 4.5 million population, Auckland 1.5 million going to 2 million. How come we absorb so much property, so much apartment, compared to the Australians, for example? There's so much around and they're not as investor-hungry as we are?
There's a question I don't actually think I know the answer to. I think part of it is that New Zealanders are quite conservative and they like that bricks-and-mortar type approach to investing. And you know, property has treated investors very, very well in New Zealand over as long as, you know, I can remember, and you look back into the statistics, and it has been a great investment. We're not, compared to Australia, we don't buy as many shares. Like, Australia has more of a share market investing culture than New Zealand does. But New Zealand, we certainly like property, and I'm always surprised at all these people I come across who I find out are property investors, and they're just ordinary people, you know, teachers and doctors.
Well, I met exactly that couple yesterday. They had about 12.6 million of property value. Really? Their debt to ratio is about, I think their loan is about 4.6 million. So they got something like almost 8 million equity. Yeah. He worked 3 days a week. Yeah. She doesn't work anymore, look after their full portfolio. Mm. Mm. They want to get ahead even more. But I said, look, if you do nothing now for the next 10 years, you're set.
Absolutely.
So that is a huge achievement.
Oh, and you know, it's amazing how much equity people have in their properties. It's huge. One of my other hats I wear is the president of the Rotorua Property Investors Association, and that's a fascinating group of people, and all the associations are, because it's just a whole mix of different ethnicities, but also different wealth, you know, or jobs, if you like. You know, some might be blue collar workers, others might be, you know, professionals and stuff. But what distinguishes a property investor from a lot of other people is that they're prepared to get off their butts and go and make, you know, do an investment and make some money and be prepared for their retirement. And that's what makes them different.
Well, I'm looking forward to pick up on your magazines and wood calls and read all about the latest information. I'm looking forward to having you back on the show.
Thank you. Maybe we should have you in the magazine on the cover one day.
Why not? Thank you for coming on the show, Phil.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Project on offer this week, we got a special for you. We're actually in the Gold Coast, Southport. We got this special property right in the heart of Southport Shopping Centre. I'm not kidding you. It's right in the corner of two streets. And you walk down, it's straight there. The shops are right in front of you. This Allegra building, it is quite an amazing design building. Curved, wavy, like the beach. Got beautiful sea views of the water, and also got excellent views back to the Gold Coast. From level 4 upwards, you're buying a one-bedroom, one-car park. Price now is from $429,000. In fact, that $429,000 unit is actually on level 14, so it's got excellent views. It comes with one car park, about 60 square metres in size. And we also got a level 6. We got a two-bedroom, two-bathroom. Believe it or not, 94 square metres. 94 square metres and for $539,000. Now, if we compare 94 square metre here in Auckland CBD, we'll be paying like double the price. So you're buying two for the price of one if you're buying the Gold Coast. Population prediction in the Gold Coast will be double by year 2050. So right now, this is sort of like the last capital in Australia for it to lift its capital growth, because during the GFC, Gold Coast took quite a big hit. Apartment market went right down and a lot of bigger developers went out of business, and now they are coming back into the market. And Sydney had its turn, Melbourne had its turn, Adelaide had its turn. Gold Coast is now on the way up. The Commonwealth game is coming there in 2018. Allegra Apartment is only 5 minutes walk from the new Olympic pool that they're building. So you want a swimming pool? Well, why would you want a swimming pool in your facility for? You just walk down the road to go to have a swim. There is no gymnasiums in the building, so the body comp is very cheap as well. So investing in an apartment building, if there's no gymnasium, no swimming pool, your body comp per week is very, very low cost. But if you're investing in the Gold Coast and you're looking for gymnasium and swimming pool, but you hardly go there, then your body comp could be $5,000 to $6,000 a year compared to $2,000 a year. The rental vacancy rate right now is only 1%, so they've got a very high take-up of the rental properties there on the Gold Coast. So if you're looking at investing in Australia, what's good about it is you still can buy properties over there with 20% deposit compared to 40% here. The Kiwi dollar now has gone, you know, like 10 years high now. We're getting about 96 cents per dollar right now. And the good thing also is right now in Australia and New Zealand, we don't take any more overseas income, meaning if you're from China, you've got Chinese incomes, they don't lend to any foreign buyers anymore because the bank doesn't take that sort of income as income anymore. But between Australia and New Zealand, we count it as one. So the bank over there will take your New Zealand income as your normal income for your borrowing. So that's your advantage. If buying in Auckland right now is so hard for you, well, buy in the Gold Coast, because we're talking about 5,500 a square metre rate versus right now some of our apartments in Auckland are 12,000 to 17,000 square metre rate. And surrounding Gold Coast also, the metre rates are 7,000 to 9,000. We also have a beachfront apartment building, and that's going on the market at 15,000 the metre rate. So it's just a matter of knowing where to go and which apartment building to choose, which location. We choose Southport because that is in the hub of the Gold Coast. That's where all the employment is happening. The Griffith University is 5 minutes from there. The Pacific Fair just had its $670 million upgrade. And the light rails now is up and running. 2018 comes. This building here will schedule to finish before Christmas this year, just in time for the Commonwealth Games. So if you want to buy one, give me a call personally because I know the building really well, and we'll take you over there for the day, show you the site, have lunch with us, and come home. And you have a investment overseas, and when you travel overseas, you can do your tax claim because you are visiting your property on that basis. And joining me now is Dev Dhingra from Fundmaster. Dev, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Don.
Look, we met in 2012 when you were still working for ASB. And at the time, you were doing loans for ASB and you decided to come out on your own, set up the Fundmaster. How has the journey been for you since?
The journey has been an amazing journey. You know, it was, when I left the bank, it was a bit, I had to think a lot that should I leave the bank or not.
Yeah.
Because from a stable job to no job and being self-employed was my first opportunity. It was a bit hazy, but I had a lot of support from my wife who had an established business at that time. And then that gave me a push to take the bungee jump. And then out. It has been a great journey. The people I've met, the customers I've met, the business partners I've met have always been very supporting. And it has been, as I said, it's a great journey so far.
Well, last week, my millionaire's tip was to encourage people to go out and be on their own business, because most people on their own business own more than two or three properties. And you are just a classic example of taking that safety net away from you and become your own independent self-employed business person. How many people have you got now working in your team?
I've got six people working in my team now.
Wow. From working for the bank, now you've got six people working in the team.
And the funny part is I'm paying them more than I used to get in the bank.
Wow. So tell me, what's your success? Like, obviously, you're lending a lot to homeowners in the beginning, and then you move up to development and so on. But what's the criteria for someone to own a home right now?
Someone to own a home, the criteria is it's called a first-home buyer. A first-home buyer is typically someone who has basically started their journey by saving some money. Once they've saved some money, they want to get into their first home. That's a first home. So that's the first time they want to buy a property. For them, the criteria is very simple. They should have 5% saved deposit. That should be their genuine savings. If you have that, it becomes easy with most of the banks. And the rest can be a gift or from family or from other sources which they can have. They must have sent the money back home, or they have saved money in KiwiSaver or other sources. So if you have 5% saved deposit and rest 5% is topped up, as a typical first-home buyer, if you want to buy any property, 10% is what your criteria is,
right,
as long as your income meets the servicing requirements set up by the banks.
So say if I buy a house for $700,000, I got $35,000 saved up, and I got $35,000 in KiwiSaver, that makes up 10%?
Yes.
So how long do you have to be in KiwiSaver to use that money?
3 years.
So if someone's on KiwiSaver for, say, 5 or 6 years, and naturally not everyone knows how much they got, but I guess if they're on KiwiSaver for 6 or 7 years, they got more than 5% already.
Exactly. And that can give them a lot of support. And people, 5% can also be, when you are young and you go into cars, you buy cars, and you buy assets which are depreciating assets where you don't make much. So that can be another way of a first-home buyer is to sell their car, get that money out, get into their first house, and they can save up again or downgrade their car value.
Right.
That's another way customers could, make their savings come into action, because buying a car is also using their savings.
Okay.
Right, so all those things can accumulate, obviously, when the customers do meet us. We can tell them how, or, sometimes customers meet us and they've got no savings. So we put them on a plan, next 6 months or next 12 months, this is what you need to do. This is how much you need to put aside every week. this is how much you need to put aside in Kiwi Seva. Stop this, stop that, get rid of your credit cards, no gem visa, no finance now. So all these things we tell our customers not to do, and we put them on a pathway so that they can be genuine first-time buyers.
And what area do you cover?
I basically cover whole of Auckland and even some loans in Christchurch and Wellington, but mainly my piece of business has been South and Central Auckland. That's where I started.
And then who's your loan provider? Who do you deal with?
We deal with all the major banks, which is ASB, ANZ, BNZ, Westpac, and also some smaller banks like Cooperative, SBS, and other banks as well, because there is a lot of peace in the market. TSB Bank has also come in.
Right.
So all those banks are there, but for typical for first-time buyers, there are options for people who are permanent residents, right? Permanent residents, they can apply through Housing New Zealand scheme as well.
Okay.
Now, that is also a very good scheme for people, which is offered by certain banks only, not all the banks, where the Housing New Zealand underwrites those loans for them, right? And that becomes a very good opportunity for customers. The criteria is a bit stringent because the income criteria cannot be more than 120K for a couple. It has to be, deposits have to be saved or can be gifted as well. But it has to be permanent residency and they have to be in their job for minimum 12 months.
Right.
Or more, they have to prove that they have been in similar jobs.
And what's the current interest rate right now?
Current interest rates, now for first-time buyers, that interest rate is quite high. But that is the first step in. So I always explain to my customers for first-time buyers is that getting in is more important.
Right.
Because equities can build over time, you can save over time, and interest rates can be lowered here and there. Because when I bought my first house, it was 9.35.
Okay.
And now, if it's a first-time buyer, it can range between 5.45 to 5.94 for certain banks. And it can also range at 15% deposit, it can range from 5% to 5.30 as well.
What's the turnaround time? Say, today you meet me, I want a loan. When would you get my loan approved by?
See, if the income criteria is all good, everything stacks up.
Yeah.
Banks, all the banks, we need at least 5 working days to come back to you with all the answers from all different banks. Normally, typically, if everything is clean and straightforward, a bank like ASB or other banks can even take 24 hours to come back.
Okay.
So it's as far as 24 hours and as worse as 5 days.
And I don't pay for that service, right?
You don't pay for anything at all to us because we get paid by the bank.
Okay, so it's a free service. No different for me going to the bank. If I can't get to the bank by 5 p.m., you come to my house at 7, I still don't pay you.
No.
Well, that's a great service.
It's a service of convenience.
Right.
Service of convenience where you know what you can afford.
Yeah.
Where you are given a clear picture that this is your pathway to afford what you want to afford. Or many people come to me and say, oh, we can't afford, we should not even meet you. But that's not the case. If you can't afford, that's the time that you've started thinking of a house.
Okay.
That's the time you need to have area knowledge. You need to understand which area you want to focus on.
Yeah.
Because people do all the things wrong. So they first want to go into a house and then they start looking into an area and school zones. And that becomes an emotional decision as a first-time buyer.
Yeah.
But if you plan that you want to buy a house, meet a mortgage advisor, understand, find out what is your capacity. Can you do it in 6 months, 2 months, 1 month? And if you can, have a pathway and start looking into areas because you being a top agent, you've seen that for a first-time buyer, it takes a lot of convincing and a lot of timing. So if they know their area, they know what they want, and they understand clearly that the market is going this way, this is the best area, then it's easy for them to go in their approval.
And I see you won some excellent awards there last year. Can you explain the awards that you won?
This came as a surprise. We would first like to make sure that we thank all our customers. Because of all our customers and business relationships, this is what we have achieved. And obviously my family and kids.
Right.
Because if they don't sacrifice their time, I don't have time for my customers. So it's for me, it's a blessing from all the customers who we meet, who have been with us, who will be with us, and who have always supported us, and people who have also not been with us and have met us, because they've also made us learn where we went wrong.
And what category award is that from the BNZ?
This is for NZFSG, New Zealand Financial Services Group Advisors.
Right.
They took out the number one advisor who had settled most loans with them for last year.
Right.
So we were number one for BNZ in that, amongst NZFSG.
That's incredible.
Amongst NZFSG advisors.
Yeah.
And we were number three in the northern region amongst all advisors in NZFSG.
So let me ask you the question. Since 2012, you work for ASB, you take out the safety net, become an independent broker. My question is, would you go back to work in your job again?
No. Not at all. Because now I have an opportunity to create a journey for myself,
right,
for my people who work with me,
right,
and also learn with them, because you learn with your people as well.
Yeah.
So when we are learning together with them and they are also learning with us, you grow. So going back to the corporate world is not going to happen for me. Well, I will make my own corporate world but a different way.
That is exactly one of my millionaire's tips, and you are a living example of that. So congratulations, and
I'm
looking forward to work with you in the near future. So thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you, Dom. Thank you.
Property of the week to offer. This week we go slightly different from residential to commercial now. So we've got this wonderful building in Great South Road Papatoetoe, number 328. We've got three vacant shops there, 160 square metre each. They are fully finished now, waiting for you to come and open your business. We have a bakery, cafe up for lease. We also have a vacant shop for a restaurant next door, or a jewellery shop, sari shop, grocery store, frozen meat, you name it, whichever business that you want to come to the location, give me a call. And Great South Road is a very, very busy location. You know, it's 5 minutes from Papatoetoe High School. Opposite it, it's a bowling club. Central Primary School is right across the road. And then also you've got Papatoetoe Swimming Pool Complex. In the weekend, you have a lot of people playing sports there. And then at 3 o'clock, Great South Road becomes a traffic jam. So for foot traffic for your business, it's great. If you want one of these properties now, you want to do the fit out, we can give you a month or 2 months rent free to do your fit out. And then you can come in and start your fit out right now, be up and coming in the next 2 or 3 months for your business to try. So these here is only three shops available. We are putting our real estate office right there in Papatoetoe because we see that's a great opportunity. At the back of the shop is also seven storage units. They are like single house-size garage and double-size garage. So if you're looking for some additional storage space, even for your office filing products, or if you have a home and you've got too much left over furniture, you can rent these for $70 a week. So we got them available. If you want to open a business or storage facility, give myself a call. I'll show you the premises. Well, millionaire's tip of the week. This has always been the favourite subject. Well, to be a millionaire, you've got to be able to plan your day and your week and your years out. So, for example, you wake up today, you don't know what to do, and you wake up tomorrow, you don't know what to do. Well, you got a problem already because your days are wasted. So you got to plan tomorrow, I'm going to meet someone. The day after that, I'm meeting someone else. So tomorrow, I'm planning to dress up, I'm going to go out to the car yard and look for that car. So right now, you go and visit your goal. You visit open home. Look at that $1 million house. If you can't afford a $1 million house, well, you go and look at one so you can walk into it, see what it feels like. You want a brand new BMW or Mercedes? Well, I remember when I was younger, I always park at T. McMillan BMW after I go home from the movies. I look at the car yard. This one was 19. Well, my first luxury car was exactly the BMW that I look at, and it was exactly the same color. And on top of that, study properties, look into the property press, go out with your local agent and pretend you want to buy a house so they can take you around and show you all these houses. And then go out with the next agent and go out with the next agent. So eventually all the local agent becomes your personal friends. Even though you're not buying anything, they might get sick of you, but you get to know how they do things. And you make offers on these properties. You might not get it because you make quite a low offer, but these are experience you must practice. You must plan your weeks out, study your products, go and visual and touch the goal that you want to become. And then in the next few years, to your surprise, you will actually get those exact things that you went and visited 3 years earlier. Well, that's it for another week. We're looking forward to see you again next week with more guests and property to share. Until then, make sure your business is working for you and don't be afraid to take action.